Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Enlightenment, A Beginner's Guide, written by Kieron O'Hara and read by Deidre Rubenstein. Preface. The Enlightenment is one of those terms that is often used, about which people have very strong opinions, yet its meaning is very hard to pin down. Some blame it for the bloody disasters of the 20th century. Auschwitz, the gulags, globalization, Islamic terrorism. Others feel its legacy needs to be protected against a neo-barbarian onslaught from supporters of intelligent design, animal rights fanatics, bloggers, and Islamic terrorists. For some, it signifies the triumph of reason. But did reason triumph over ignorance or diversity? Has it brought tolerance or hypocrisy? Does it support equality of women and men, non-white people and whites? Or alternatively, is it a covert attempt to force women or non-white people to deny their own voices, reject their distinct inheritances, and adopt European ways? Is it driving humankind to use science in an insane, unstoppable rape of our planetary resources? Or are its discoveries the key to maximizing human welfare? The debates still rage. A short introduction cannot hope to resolve these issues, but it should be possible to provide some pointers. Where are the agreements and disagreements? Where the errors and misconceptions? What significance can we draw when we hear the term enlightenment used in social or political discourse? That is the aim of this book, a deliberately small book, a daunting aim for its author. As the Enlightenment is such a distributed and heterogeneous group of phenomena, events, and institutions, our survey will perforce have to be selective. As I will argue, the Enlightenment is an identifiable movement with underlying continuities, six aspects of which I will sketch in the opening chapter. In the next two chapters, I will briefly examine the progress of the Enlightenment and its distribution in space. The Enlightenment was about ideas, which the next five chapters will consider. Chapter 4 will sketch the intellectual origins of the Enlightenment, looking at its precursors and its founders. Chapter 5 will look at the philosophy of the era, including the central aspects of the philosophy of knowledge, epistemology, and the philosophy of mind. Chapter 6 will review the most abiding philosophical developments in political philosophy. Chapter 7 will look at the new scientific views of nature, while Chapter 8 will examine religious ideas. Next, Chapter 9 will look at the effects of the revolution in ideas on artistic expression. Chapter 10 will consider the legacy of the Enlightenment in the present day and review attitudes both pro and anti. And the final chapter will draw on all of these elements in briefly examining the significance of Enlightenment ideas during the last 200 years. This is a survey of a long period of time, which ranges over two continents and several kinds of artistic and political endeavor. I have chosen to arrange the material thematically rather than chronologically. Many names, not all of them familiar, crop up, and rather than interrupt the text for introductions, I have placed the names of some of the more important figures in a list at the end of the book, which gives their dates and nationalities, as well as a very brief characterization of their achievements. This, I hope, will serve to orient the listener as he or she moves through the text, and also act as a starting point for further study. The dates of birth and death of those not mentioned in the biographical section will be given in the text upon their first appearance. Throughout the book, names and titles have been anglicized, except where a non-English name is more familiar. The major writers of the Enlightenment are relatively little read in the 21st century. Some works remain popular: Candide, Gulliver's Travels, Robinson Crusoe. But many of the great philosophical and historical works, such as Locke's essay, Hume's treatise, Kant's Critique of Pure Reason, or Gibbon's Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, are more referred to than read. While in the Anglophone world at least, remarkably few readers recognize the names of the greatest philosophes, including Diderot, Condorcet, and Montesquieu. There are some excellent anthologies of Enlightenment texts, and in this book I have purposely leaned heavily on Isaac Kramnik's The Portable Enlightenment Reader, which happily remains in print, in order that the student might be able to find a selection of excerpts from a good range of enlightened writers, scientists, and thinkers in one convenient place. My thanks are due in particular to David Stevens, Marsha Filion, Dawn Sackett, and an anonymous referee for comments and criticisms of previous drafts, all of which improved the book immensely. It should, but rarely does, go without saying that responsibility for remaining errors and infelicities lies solely with the author. Chapter 1. Introduction. Aspects of Enlightenment. For a definition of enlightenment, we do have a handy starting point. At the pinnacle of the age, 1784, one of the leading philosophers of the Enlightenment, Immanuel Kant, wrote a short piece entitled, What is Enlightenment? That piece is a splendidly concise summary of much of the preceding epoch, but nevertheless hints at some of the difficulties of definition. Kant is commendably direct. His first sentence defines enlightenment as man's release from his self-incurred tutelage. The goal is intellectual freedom. People need to be liberated from authority. Kant's motto for the age is sapere aude, often translated as dare to know. So the search for intellectual freedom is a moral one, and failure to embark on it is owing to laziness and cowardice. One should argue with authority, because one should claim the freedom to make public use of one's reason at every point. That is not to say that we should be wrangling perpetually. We play various roles in life which quite properly restrict our freedom. But we have an individual core at the center of our being, which should dare to know, argue, and find out. Kant gives the example of a clergyman who is obligated to the church to give orthodox sermons to his flock, but as a scholar, it is his duty to test such orthodoxy against his reason, to question and argue. The enlightened man challenges orthodoxy, argues against authority when his reason is compromised, and understands the limits to his reason, dictated by the roles he plays in society. That is an important goal, but picking it apart exposes many of the tensions of the Enlightenment. For instance, the listener will no doubt have noticed its gendered language. Enlightened thinkers of both sexes, even the important feminist thinker Mary Wollstonecraft, usually referred to man or mankind, meaning all people, men and women. And it is certainly futile and anachronistic to condemn writers of a quarter of a millennium ago for lacking sensitivities we now possess. But their assumptions were indeed often sexist, And so the gendered language can also betray an unmotivated privileging of men's experience over women's. Kant, for example, asserts that the attempt to use one's own reason is held to be very dangerous by the far greater portion of mankind and by the entire fair sex. In this book, I shall generally use the gendered language used by the people on whom I am commentating, because to do otherwise would risk misstating key positions, and will leave the very difficult question of evaluating sexism to the listener. Together with the additional question, if sexism be shown, of identifying whether it crucially undermines the arguments of the texts it appears in. Kant is also unashamedly elitist. New prejudices will serve as well as old ones to harness the great unthinking masses. He is very nervous of the idea that letting all individuals think for themselves is the best way to promote enlightened values. He much prefers the idea that a radical prince, he is thinking of Frederick the Great of Prussia, should shepherd his people out of barbarity. Only an enlightened despot, with a numerous and well-disciplined army, he thinks, can let his people argue. A republic could not dare say such a thing. A greater degree of civil freedom appears advantageous to the freedom of mind of the people, and yet it places inescapable limitations upon it. A lower degree of civil freedom, on the contrary, provides the mind with room for each man to extend himself to his full capacity. Indeed, Kant denied that he lived in an enlightened age at all, though we do live in an age of enlightenment. The Enlightenment, even for the foremost philosopher of the age, had not produced enlightenment for the mass of people, even by 1784. How, then, should a beginner's guide proceed? The Enlightenment has very blurry borders, and no one quite agrees on the fine detail, but there is a core that can be described. My hope in this book will be to guide the beginner around that core, so that she or he can get to know the rough territory and start to make her own judgments about the age. In the following sections, I will sketch out some representative Enlightenment positions, with the firm caveats that thinkers of other eras have had similar ideas, and that enlightened thinkers could sometimes hold very uncharacteristic opinions. But if one does not mind generalizing enormously, one can provide a not inaccurate view of the key aspects of the processes and products of enlightened thought. Aspect 1. New sources of authority, particularly grounded in human capacities. Any kind of belief, be it scientific, religious, philosophical, political, or common sense, has a justification, a reason why it is believed. In the Enlightenment, there was a broad and general shift in the accepted justifications of belief away from authorities and toward the individual, who was expected to take more responsibility for the beliefs he held. This attitude was at least partly due to the social changes brought about by increased literacy, and was not unnaturally concentrated in the towns. The social mix allowed more people access to a larger number of opinions jostling to be heard. Older sources of authority, such as the king, God, the Bible, or tradition, lost their hold, and newer ones, such as experimental observation, reason, and logic, became more respectable. The past has no claim on the future. As Kant put it, an age cannot bind itself and ordain to put the succeeding one into such a condition that it cannot extend its, at best very occasional, knowledge, purify itself of errors, and progress its general enlightenment. Seemingly neutral between a moral and a practical claim. Jean Laurent d'Alembert's take was that genuine philosophes respect that which they ought to, and prize that which they can. This is their real crime. That is, the real reason for their notoriety. The opinion of the people also became important, as Jean-Jacques Rousseau's theories about the general will were adapted by Robespierre and the French revolutionaries. To make all that clearer, let's take three examples. Many used to believe that the legitimacy of a ruler that made it obligatory for his subjects to obey him derived directly from God, the divine right of kings. In the Enlightenment, the idea of a social contract emerged, whereby subjects obeyed the king only in return for various services that the king was contractually obliged to perform, such as providing law and order, protection from want or outside invasion. Listen to chapter 6 for more on this. So, although royalism declined during the Enlightenment, it didn't disappear. While a royalist like Voltaire would rest his arguments on a strongly argued rational case, not on the realities of tradition or power. A second example is religious belief. Whereas in the 17th century one was expected to conform to the religion of one's country, and one could easily find oneself executed for holding the wrong beliefs, there was much argument in the 18th century that toleration of all religions was important, because God was less appreciative of someone getting it right than of them making a genuine attempt to understand religious truth, even if they got it wrong. Thirdly, science arose as authority, particularly religious authority or the authority of the great classical thinkers such as Aristotle or Galen, declined. Listen to chapter 7. Truth about the world was found not in the library or the Bible, but via investigation of the phenomena in the world, with experiment and observation. If observations went against authority, so much the worse for authority. There were three important corollaries of this new attitude. First, the power of tradition was markedly reduced, and old habits and attitudes were almost automatically questioned. The 18th century was a period of self-conscious modernization. Secondly, there was a general increase in toleration. People with opposing views should be able, it was felt, to live peacefully alongside each other, as long as those views did not affect other people materially. Pierre Bayle argued that people cannot be forced to believe, pointing out that each of us generally strives to obey God as best we can in good faith, even though we diverge, and this is generally unproblematic. On the other hand, we can recognize when people are doing evil and can deal with them accordingly. A stronger argument, honed by John Locke in his Letter Concerning Toleration, was that the religious and secular spheres are and should be kept separate. The policing of conscience is simply beyond the competence and authority of the magistrate. The third corollary of the new attitude was that the individual became more important as a political entity. Correspondingly, more time was devoted to studying and theorizing the psychology of the individual, and individual liberty was increasingly seen as an important political goal. The work of Isaiah Berlin and others reminds us that liberty can be interpreted in many different ways, in the Enlightenment as much as in any era. But, however broadly construed,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.